Hi everyone, just want to let you know my first creepypasta has been delayed to next year, so hope you guys understand. Alright, let's begin the narration. The hospital door swung open as Nelson and his EMTs wheeled Lincoln inside and down a long hall leading to the ER, with Rita and Lindsay following close behind. Once they reached the ER doors, however, a nurse stopped the two of them from going any further as several doctors and nurses took Lincoln into the ER. "I'm sorry, Mr. and Mrs. Loud, but visitors are not allowed in the ER without permission. You need to wait inside the waiting room for now. The doctor will inform you of your son's condition once he's being examined," the nurse informed them.
"No, I want to leave his side,"
Rita insisted, but Lindsay held her back. "Rita, calm down," he urged her. "There's nothing we can do. We'll only be in the way." Rita and visit at first, but then give in when she realized that arguing would get them anywhere. So she and Lindsay followed Nelson into the large waiting room, where Lori and her sisters currently were. They all displayed expressions of fear, sorrow, and uncertainty. Luann was there as well, but she sat far across the room, away from the rest of her family, too ashamed to even look at them. Lori was currently texting Bobby and her new college friends about what happened to Lincoln when she looked up to see Rita and Lindsay enter the room.
"Mom, Dad, how's Lincoln?"
Lori questioned worriedly.
"Bad,"
Lindsay answered. "One of his lungs apparently got punctured by a broken rib and filled with blood. The EMTs had to drain it with a draw cord in the ambulance so he wouldn't suffocate."
"Oh God."
Lori placed her hands into her mouth in shock.
"Where is he now?"
Lindsay asked. "Lincoln's in the ER," Lindsay said. "They're examining him now, but they will notify us of his condition once they thoroughly examine him."
"Well, I just hope Lincoln doesn't die of this,"
Lucy replied in a low tone.
"Don't say that, Lucy," Rita scolded.
"Lincoln's a very strong kid. He'll pull through. I know he will."
Meanwhile, in the ER, Lincoln was currently being run through a CT X-ray unit by a doctor named Lord Florence and board nurses. He had recently transferred from the hospital in Teaneck, New Jersey to Royal Woods, Michigan a year ago, and was known as the best doctor and surgeon in all of Royal Woods. Before Lloyd became a surgeon back in Teaneck, he served as an EMT officer in the Teaneck Volunteer Ambulance Corps for 5 years, and he's been responsible for many cases of prank involve earned injuries, and some involving broken arms and legs to dissolved jaws and fractured hips. But this was by far the worst he ever seen. Lloyd had been informed by Nelson about the cause of Lincoln's injuries, and I pretty much guessed it that he was in for some very unpleasant results, and he was correct about that. In the CT scan results displayed on the computer screen in front of Lloyd, it showed a massive skull fracture in Lincoln's forehead, with a piece of shattered skull actually embedded it into the frontal lobe of the brain. Lincoln's terminal lobe also showed signs of cervical bruising and the box area of the brain, and a few other areas also received heavy damage. Lincoln's spine had also been broken near his waistline area, And as one of the ENTs had suspected earlier, the scan revealed that three of Lincoln's right side ribs had been broken, which had caused a puncture in his right lung. His left rib cage also had two broken ribs. But luckily, they hadn't punctured his left lung. Lloyd didn't know how it was possible for a 14-year-old kid that resolved injuries to this extent and still be alive. But by the same miracle, or perhaps by rampant infusion, Lincoln was able to pull through. Lori knew without surgery, though, Lincoln wouldn't survive for long.
"That's far worse than I thought," Lloyd said, turning to the nurses.
We need to get him to the surgery room right away. I need to operate him immediately."
"Right away, Doc," one of the nurses nodded.
Then she and the other nurses rushed into the CT scan room with the stretcher.
"This is going to take a while," Lloyd said as he watched Lincoln being gently on the stretcher through the glass window of the room, separating him from the scanner chamber and the ionist chamber.
I need to fix his skull and try to mend his spine in the best I can.
Then we set the broken bone in his forearm and rib cage.
A few minutes later, Lincoln was in the surgery room, being prepared for the long surgery by Lloyd and his team of nurses. An IV needle with a sleeping medication was inserted in Lincoln's left arm. A few areas of his head shaved for the brain surgery, and the heart monitor and rapido was hooked up to it. This also had to strip Lincoln down to just his socks and underpants in order to reach the areas where the surgery can be performed for his spine. After doing this, the surgery began. It was around 5:14 p.m. By this time, Lincoln's surgery was fully complete, and his parents and siblings were still patiently waiting for the results. A nurse informed that several hours ago that Lincoln would be heading into surgery, yet they wasn't informed as long it would take, nor to what injuries he had received.
"Mom, do you think Lincoln will be alright after this?" Lola asked, still worried.
"I don't know, Lola," Rita replied. "We just have to wait till what the doctor says."
As if on cue, the doors to the ER opened, and the doctor with brown cue cut style hair into the room. It was Lloyd. He noticed the Ladd family all waiting in the corner of the waiting room, and headed towards Rita Lynn Sr.
"Hello there. You must be Mr. and Mrs. Ladd, I presume," he grunted.
"Yes," Rita stood up. "I'm Lincoln's mother, Rita Ladd. Lynn Sr. here is my husband, and these are ten girls. Here are our children."
Lloyd was surprised at how many siblings Lincoln had. He had never met a family with this many children before. Yet this made Lloyd feel a bit bad due to the results he had from Lincoln's condition. He had ever been the bearer of bad news, and this was definitely one of those times.
"I'm Dr. Lloyd Florence, the one who performed the surgery on your son, Lincoln Loud," Lloyd introduced himself.
"Oh, Doc, please tell me Lincoln's all right," Rita petrically pleaded.
"He's still alive, right?" Lana asked Lloyd.
Lloyd sighed and then said,
"Yes, he's alive, and he'll live."
Rita and the rest of her family looked greatly revered, including Luann, and Lincoln said in a painful tone,
"Oh, thank God."
But Lloyd held out his hand and said in a firm tone,
"You didn't let me finish. Now I said that Lincoln will live, but I wouldly exile call it living."
Rita, Monsignor, and the rest of the family frowned in both confusion and concern.
"What do you mean, Dr. Florence?" Monsignor asked the concern.
Laura took a deep breath, then said in a regretful tone,
What I mean is that Lincoln will live, but he will never be the same again. The injuries he received from the refrigerator falling on him were extremely severe, so much so that I can't understand how he didn't die from it. Lincoln should be dead, but he isn't. His spine got broken near his waistline area, so he'd be paralyzed from the waist down, meaning he would be concerned to a wheelchair for the remainder of his life. Because of this, his back will also be in the canceled agony for the rest of his life as well. Lincoln won't able to do as much as twist himself, left or right, without causing himself pain. I did my best to try to repair the spinal damage, but it was too severe to completely fix. So Lincoln is not gonna be ever walk. So Lincoln's not going to be walking ever again.
No, Lincoln.
Rita gasps in shock and begins to tear up. Lancy and the others just as shocked, but Luann looked even more shocked. She also began to cry as well. Yes, Lloyd said sadly. Like I said, it's bad, but I sorry to say, this isn't the worst of it.
What are you saying?
Rita asked with tears in her eyes. Lloyd was almost too afraid to speak, worried about how the family would react, but he knew that they deserved to know the truth. Dying with a bit of hesitation, Lloyd said. Lincoln's brain reserved probably some of the worst damage imaginable. His skull got surgically fractured and cracked in several areas, which damaged and inspired some of the higher brain functions. The worst part being his forehead. A piece of Lincoln's cracked skull actually got stabbed into the frontal lobe of his brain from the force of impact. And his terminal lobe, was bruised very badly, which damaged the cerebral cortex. Because of this, Lincoln would end up in severe memory loss. He may not remember who you are, or even who himself is. Over time his brain heals, he might recover some, but not all of his memories. He'll end up having memory gaps because of it. Due to the damage done to the frontal lobe, Lincoln will also no longer be able to concern senses, care for himself, nor eat properly. He'll have to be taken care of for the rest of his life, such as being fed, dressed, bathed, and also have to be put in diapers as well. Until he can be exerted enough to use the toilet, if even possible. To sum it all up, Lincoln's mind probably ended up being set back to a mindset of a toddler or mentally retarded person. And all to be this way for the rest of his life. I mean, no offense when I say this, but if you were me in Lincoln's shoes, I have to have much rather perform death. But like I said, this isn't what I call living. Time seemed to stand still for the entire Loud family. And these horrible words left Lloyd's mouth. They'll doubly wish that this was just a horrible nightmare, and they will wake up safe at home. But there's no way they could deny what they just heard. Nor they could fool themselves. They all know for a doubt fact that it was true, and there was no denying it. Why would the doctor have any reason to lie to them?
No, no, no!
Rita broke down in tears, sobbing uncontrollably.
My boy, Lindsay whispered, tearing up as well. This can't be happening,
Lisa whispered, with tears in her eyes. The rest of Lincoln siblings lost and began crying uncontrollably as well. Even Lily. Luann, however, feels sick from hearing what she just heard from the doctor to tell them all. Lincoln was now in shallow form herself. It was all her fault. She felt a bit of raise of her throat, but Luann forced it back as hard as she could, not wanting to show such weakness in front of her family by puking.
Luann was now 17 years old now, and she wouldn't let her weak pie to get the better of her. I'm really sorry, but there's nothing I can do about it. Believe me, when I say I've tried, but Lincoln's injuries were just too far severe to completely fix, Lloyd said with a sad face.
Where is he now?
Rita asked, wiping tears from her face. He's in the recovery room right now, but he's not conscious yet. The anesthesia haven't fully worn off yet, so Lincoln will be asleep for at least another hour or so, Lloyd answered.
Can we see him?
Lynn Sr. asked. Yes, I'll show you all to the recovery room, Lloyd said, leading Rita and Lynn Sr. towards the ER doors, with their daughters following behind them. Behind the doors was a long T-shaped hall with a sign on the wall at the end. The left hall led to the surgery room, and the right hall led to the recovery room. Two doors near the ER entrance led to the X-ray room, and the CT scan, room where Lincoln had been examined hours earlier. Lloyd had led the Lau family down the right hall, and six hospital beds against the wall. Five of them were empty, but the bed farthest to the left was occupied by none other than Lincoln, now in a blue hospital gown with the front slightly open. He had an IV needle in his left arm, which supplied his body with fluids to keep him hydrated. A cast went around his right arm and bandages around his around his chest and head. A heart monitor was also hooked up to Lincoln's chest to monitor his vessels.
Lincoln!
Rita gasped, placing her hands to her mouth in shock.
Bro!
Lana gasped as well, feeling tears running down her face.
Son!
A teary-eyed Lincoln stuttered, approaching Lincoln's bed. Soon the rest of Lincoln's sisters being crowded his bed, each of them crying softly. Lily even reached her hands out towards Lincoln with a sad expiration, but he was held back by Lloyd. Turning his head to Lloyd, Rita asked,
How long will he need to be here? Will his recovery take a while?
Well, I managed to stitch up his punctured lung and his fractured brain lobe with Ben and I stitches and reset his broken ribs. I also reset the broken bone in Lincoln's left forearm and stitched the punctured flesh wound up before putting the cast on it. And I mended his skull and spine as the best I could. His broken arm should fully heal in a few weeks or so. However, it will be at least a month or so until Lincoln's internal injuries fully heal. So he'll be in the hospital for at least a month at best, Lloyd explained. Rita wasn't too surprised by this, nor was Lynn Sr. and the rest of the family. With the amount of injuries Lincoln sustained, it was no surprise that he'd be in the hospital bound for a long period of time recovering. Waking up to the bed, Lola tapped Lincoln's shoulder and said,
Lincoln, can you hear me? Wake up!
Miss, he's not conscious yet. The sleep medication won't wear off for about another hour, Lloyd informed the young beauty queen.
Will he forget all of us forever?
Lola asked Lloyd fearfully. I really don't know, kiddo, Lloyd replied sadly. Like I said earlier, Lincoln may recover a little of his memories, but not all of them. He may not remember who all of you are, but he might recognize a few of you. I can only hope that Lincoln recovers enough of his memory, that he doesn't forget all of you.
Can we stay with him until he wakes up? I don't want Lincoln to be alone when he awakens,
Rita asked. Yes, of course, Lloyd nodded. Visiting hours are from 8 a.m. to 9 p.m. Stay as long as you wish. I have to attend some other patients right now, so I'll take my leave for now. Just call me while the nurse is on the bedside speaker if Lincoln wakes up, and we'll be here to check on him momentarily. Lloyd then left the recovery room, leaving the Loud family alone with Lincoln. As soon as they were alone, Rita and Senior glared over at Luann with a very angry expression, and so do her sisters. The rage that they all had in their eyes made Luann feel like a tiny little calf being cornered by an angry wolf. Luann, I'm going to ask you only once. You better answer me honestly. Do you know what have you done? Lansinger asked in a surprisingly calm tone, but Luann could tell he was furious.
I know.
Luann sniffed nervously. She was too upset to speak the truth.
You don't.
I have a very hard time to believe in that. Lansinger said coldly, thinking that Luann hadn't been paying that close attention to what Dr. Lloyd had just told all of them. Luann just shook her head no and said,
I didn't mean for any of this to happen. You gotta believe me, I swear. I don't know if that leg on the fridge was loose enough to where it caused it to fail on Lincoln.
Luann, it doesn't matter whatever you knew the leg was loose. I'm sure you didn't intend to drop the fridge on Lincoln, but it was the cause of the effect of your recklessness. Rita chimed in.
I'm sorry. I don't want this to happen. I'll never prick anyone again, I swear.
The way that instance with a tear forming in her eyes again. Luann, do you have any idea how many times we all hear you say that? How you change your ways and start pulling pranks on us on April Fool's Day, and so on? Well, I hate to break to you, Luann, but we're not buying that anymore, Lansinger replied.
I can't stay grounded forever,
Luann muttered.
Oh, you're damn right about that, Luann.
Lansinger snapped angrily. But that's not all that's going to happen.
What do you mean?
Luann stormed nervously. As soon as we return home, I want you to go up to your room and remove every single prank prop, joke book, and anything that falls under the comedy category from it and have them ready to go to Goodwill. Lindsay informed firmly, as of today, your career as a prank star and a comedian is over.
What? But comedy is my lifelong dream.
Luann possessed. I'm sorry, Luann, Lindsay said, shaking his head. But we can't allow you to pursue that career path any longer. The damage you caused to this family and to you and to Lincoln because of your path as a comedian is very inevitable and unforgivable. Every single year during April Fool's Day, you find new and sometimes very reckless ways to pull pranks on your family and our family and in my house. Your mother and I are full-grown adults, and what do you do rather than stand up for the family to put a stop to you? We hide in the military bunker like a bunch of cowards and let you have your way. Well, for the first time in our lives, your mother and I are growing thicker spine and taking the stand this time. As of today, pranking, telling puns, old jokes, and any sort of officially is strictly taboo in our household. Also, like I said, you're all gonna get rid of anything that in your room that falls under the category, with expiration of your dummy, Mr. Coconuts. Him, you can keep. As just letting you know, Luann, which Rita said firmly, this is not a prank to get back to you like last year with the stunt actors. This time we're being deadly serious here. In addition to this, you will no longer be able to allow to work in that drug shop of yours. Your father and I will find a part-time job for your order to help us pay for all Lincoln's hospital bills, and you will be required to help us take care of them as long as you live in our house. Mm.
And also, you're the grounded for the remainder of the year, Via, for what have you done. Let's just pray to God in heaven above that Lincoln doesn't die from this, Lindsay concluded. Luann felt beyond horrible, not just because she wasn't able to pursue her career from being grounded, but because of what Lincoln had been reduced to the result of her failed prank. She could only hope that Lincoln would forgive her if he still even knew who she was and still capable of doing so.
He won't die, right? Luann stormed.
The doctor said Lincoln will live, but from the injuries he described to us, Rita paused and shook her head.
I just don't know. I'm sorry,
Luann whimpered. Shut up, Luann. Just shut your damn mouth. I don't want to hear any more of how sorry you are, Lincoln snapped coldly. If you're really sorry, then you live with the consequences of your actions, and you'll start by doing what your mother and I told you to do. You're 17 years old now, and almost a legal adult, so you're going to be treated like an adult and face the consequences like an adult. The wind just carried away from the hospital bed, saying nothing else. About an hour later in the recovery room, Lincoln began to slowly open his eyes. His parents and sisters were unaware of it, and his first sense they were all sitting in chairs alongside the wall. Yet his mother's attention was down to him, where he let out a grunt from his bed. Lincoln? Rita said, gazing up from Lily in her lap out of the hospital bed. Lindsay and the others also turned the attention to Lincoln's bed. As he opened his eyes fully, he was still visibly dazed from the sleep medication. Lincoln muttered in a weak, slowed voice. Lincoln! Lincoln examined the relief, watching up to Lincoln's hospital bed. The rest of the family soon gathered around the bed, including the wind who made direct eye contact with Lincoln in hopes that he would still recognize her. Lori called for Dr. Lloyd, and Lincoln spit on his speaker, informed that Lincoln had awoken from sleep.
Lincoln?
Luann began shedding tears of remorse.
I'm sorry. I'm so sorry this happened to you. I never meant for this to happen. I swear. Please forgive me.
Lincoln didn't respond, but he didn't widen his eyes and tilted his head to the left a bit, with a somewhat confused and downfounded expression on his face. He then turned his head to the left, then to the right, and grunted, if he had no idea where he was or what had happened.
Lincoln, it's me, Luann,
Luann said nervously.
Don't you recognize me?
Lincoln looked back at her, then said in a merely retarded tone,
Luann, who are you?
Luann stopped back in shock and gasped.
No, he doesn't know who you are, Luann.
Lainey said on a verge of tears. Why is he talking like that? Lana wondered.
Lincoln can't speak because of the damage down the brain, like the doctor said. Remember? Lisa replied. Just send the doctor Lloyd into the room and approached Lincoln's bed.
Ah, so he is awake, Lloyd replied, lifting up the clipboard in his hand. I didn't ask him a few questions on how much he remembers. Lincoln looked up at Dr. Lloyd with the same confused look he had when looking out of the wind, then tried to speak again.
You,
Lincoln said, struggling to speak right.
I'm Dr. Lloyd Florence, Lloyd answered, opening a pen with his other hand.
You're in the Royal Wars Hospital. You're having an accident involved with one of your sister's pranks. Do you remember anything? And do you still recognize anything in your room? In this room?
Lincoln didn't seem to understand what Lloyd was asking due to the brain damage, but he appeared to be trying to process what was going on around him.
Lincoln looked down at him, then up at Lloyd with a slight frown.
What?
Lincoln started desperately struggling to speak properly. Rita Lynn Sr. teared up as he heard Lincoln ask that question. Has he lost all his memories? Had he really forgotten who all his family members were?
Lincoln, it's us, your family,
Rita petulantly pleaded, grabbing his hand.
It's me, your mother. Please remember. Ma? You, Ma?
Lincoln asked, still dazed. Ma'am, I don't think he recognizes you, or any of you, or any of your rest of the family, Lloyd said, writing notes on the clipboard. Like I said, it may be a while until some of Lincoln's memories return. His carnival cortex got badly damaged. It's going to be a while until he heals up enough for him to recover some of his memory.
So he remember us when that happens, right?
Rita asks.
Perhaps it'd be impossible to tell us of now, but we'll know in a few weeks or so.
Lloyd answered, turning back to Lincoln. Oh my goodness. Lincoln, I don't know if you can understand me yet, but do you recognize anyone in this room? Can you remember anything at all?
Lincoln
stayed looking over his parents' instances with a hazy expiration. He stared long and hard at them, then slowly turned his head towards Rita and his eyes widened a bit. Then he said,
Ma?
Rita nodded and grabbed his good hand with both of his hands and said in a sad voice,
Yes, baby, it's me, your mother. Do you recognize me?
Lincoln looked directly at his mother with tears running down her face. Then he said with a slow nod,
Ma. You, Ma?
A revealed expression came over Rita's face when she heard Lincoln's reply. He apparently had his memory of her, but she wasn't sure if Lincoln would remember the rest of the family yet.
Who are they?
Lincoln asked, pointing at his sisters. Rita glanced at them and said,
They are your sisters, Lincoln. Your dad's the person next to me. You remember them, right?
Lincoln just stared at his father and his sisters, who all had tears in their eyes, along with worried expressions. He looked at each one, then grunted in a confused manner if he had trouble guessing who they were. Lincoln grunted, shaking his head slowly. Rita failed to draw a sour watch through her when he said that. But she remembered what Lloyd had said about the memory gap due to his damaged cerebral cortex. She could only hope that over time, Lincoln remembered that his sisters as his brain healed.
It appears that Lincoln seems to remember you, Mrs. Loud. However, he didn't seem to remember his family sisters yet. Hopefully that might not change once his brain heals over time, Lloyd said, writing notes on his clipboard.
I hope so, Rita said in a worried tone.
Does he even know where is he at, or what's happening to him? Or what's happened to them? Lynn Sr. asks.
Lincoln seems to be aware of something being out of place. I thought that he was able to understand the current situation going on here, Lloyd answered.
Remember, his mind resolved back into a toddler-like state to the extreme brain damage as he suffered that fridge falling on him. For what I have analyzed here, Lincoln still emphasized some higher forms of the communication, such as understanding speech and body language. However, as you all can see here, he's not able to speak properly from four sentences due to the brain damage he received. Frankly, I am amazed that Lincoln is able to still even understand human speech in this early in his recovery, let alone speak. There was something I didn't expect.
At least Lincoln still remembers his mother, Lincoln said with a bit of relief. Lincoln just continued to turn his hair left and white, staring out the walls and at the family a few times. He appeared to be lost in his own world, and completely naive, and completely had happened back to the house. His exploration now the mildly retarded personal completely devastated in emotion. Yet Lincoln appeared to realize that something was off, since he was able to, since he was in the hospital bed with bandages all over him. Dr. Lord was also amazed that Lincoln was even able to speak at all this early in his recovery, let alone understand human speech. He had never dealt with children as received injuries as sober. Yet Lloyd had seen few patients spot in very similar injuries in the past that have resulted in high-speed vehicle crashes. Lloyd recalled seeing a teenage patient a year ago that's been paralyzed from the waist down and received heavy brain damage from the DUI crash involving a big rig driver. The big rig driver had passed out drunk behind the wheel of his truck and hit a snail. Hit a small stunned HD at fully 85 miles per hour, mildly wondering the male teenager driver inside of it. His injuries was almost as bad as Lincoln's, but unlike Lincoln, he didn't survive the trip to the hospital and scabbed the injuries which resulted in death. Lord can only hope that Lincoln will want to meet the same fate, even if he won't be exactly like he had started earlier. This is probably the only patient I've seen survive this long after seeing the type of injuries they can receive. None of the other patients I've seen in the past several injuries like this more than an hour. Yet Lincoln is still living and breathing, Lloyd said. Rita looked at Lloyd and asked, how many patients have you seen that got injured the way Lincoln did? If I remember correctly, about 4. And there were all adults with expiration with one being a teenage driver. But unlike Lincoln here, none of them survived more than an hour or two at best. So I have to say he's the luckiest kid alive, Lloyd answered. I'm not denying deserved intonation, being possibly given the circumstances here. Normally any person at this age would originally die from having happily appliance like a refrigerator drawn upon them, but they can survive it. But how we live, Lloyd asks. He will be looked after the rest of his life, like I mentioned before, Lloyd said. Lincoln will have sent to a wheelchair since he's paralyzed from the waist down, and he's definitely have a resorted since his mind's been set back to a toddler like state due to his brain damage he received from a prank accident. So leave our life, your parents and your sisters. We need to look after them when the time comes. I know this may be hard, all of you, but this is how it's got to be. Lincoln's parents and sisters all gazed at him with tears in his eyes, including the wind. He no longer cared that she was grounded and forced to give up comedy for life. Now, after seeing just how bad Lincoln really was after waking up, the wind would gladly give it up and to see her brother back to normal again. But she knew it was impossible. The wind now began reflecting on all the times that her parents and her sisters wanted to stop with the pranks and how her promise many times that over so easy from now on, only to go back to the world afterwards. And now, as a result of the wind's recklessness, Lincoln had almost been killed. I should have quit when you all said to, the wind thought, that as tears drenched her face. I'm so sorry, Lincoln. You like this because of me, and it's all my fault. The wind knew that her apologies would never make up for the mistakes she had made, but she could only hope that her family would forgive her as time went on, and she prayed that Lincoln would remember her over time, his injuries, once he recovered from his injuries.
Lorraine didn't know if Lincoln would ever forgive her, if his memory of the events would return once his brain healed. But she only could hope, that his mind wasn't go too far for him to understand forgiveness. For Lorraine, things seemed hopeless, and she didn't know what to do. Lorraine had no doubt that her friends and Lincoln's friends would hate her very existence once they learned about what had happened to Lincoln as a result of her recklessness since panicking. But she couldn't blame anyone but herself if that had come to it. You know, that was a burden that Lorraine knew to bear to the rest of her life, and she'd taken on to her grave. Comedy meant nothing to Lorraine now, only her brother.
Forgive me, Lincoln.
Lorraine thought, glancing over at Lincoln, which made brief eye contact with her. And just for a brief second, Lorraine could have sworn she noticed a spark of recognition in his eyes.